good afternoon. Let me begin as in American TV show. I'm your host, Piotr Łukasiewicz from Pulaski Foundation and former ambassador, Polish ambassador to Afghanistan. Let me introduce my our guest, starting from my left, Sir Richard Barrett, former director of global counterterrorism for MI6, British Secret Services, and member of the United Nations Al Qaeda and Taliban monitoring team, currently vice president of Soufan Group. Next is Professor Gilles Dorronsoro, professor of French Sorbonne, specialist in rebel administrations, and field researcher who spent, well, years in rebel-controlled areas in Afghanistan during the Mujahideen time, during Taliban, and also recently he did research in Syria, in Kurdistan, on refugees. Next we have Professor Richard English from St. Andrews University in Scotland, historian and sociologist. Next we have Mr. Yoram Schweitzer, former member of Israeli intelligence community, senior research fellow of the and head of the program on terrorism and low intensity conflict at the Institute for National Security Studies. And last but not least is Ambassador Peter Semneby, specialist in European security policies, who in the last few years developed exotic taste for war zones and was Swedish ambassador to Afghanistan, and currently is representing Sweden as a head of the mission in Damascus, Syria. the topic of, I would like to start our conversation giving you a story, a fairy tale, of the single man named, let's say, Mr. Issa, on the journey from Syria or Afghanistan on the boat going to Europe with the difficult past. Maybe he was trained, maybe he did some fighting previously, maybe not, we don't know that. And he's going to Europe with the unknown goals, and what is expecting him in Europe? That would be a part of our story. What is the reception he's going to receive in Europe from the society, from the European societies, or from the European institutions that are meant to protect the security in Europe? So, having this background story of our discussion, I would like to start with Ambassador Semneby. To give us a political description of what's happening right now in Syria and Iraq, especially with the recent developments in Aleppo and Mosul, and to give the political answer whether refugees are just poor people who are coming out of miserable situation, or are they also being used as a political tool against what? Against Europe, against the Middle East. So, Peter, please.
Well, thank you, Piotr. These are obviously not easy questions to answer. Well, what is going on in Syria at the moment is the latest, but I fear not the last, chapter in the very tragic story of the fragmentation of that country. We are now seeing the attempt to eliminate from on the part of the Syrian regime and their backers the most important opposition-held enclaves that are being the most important one being Eastern Aleppo, but there are others as well. I believe that this is being done deliberately at this moment because of a lack of ability to take forceful decisions on the part of the world community. That means that we will probably see a lot more bloodletting in and around Aleppo and possibly also in other areas in the months to come. This will of course also lead to further displacement beyond the almost unfathomable figures that we have in terms of displacement in Syria, with half of the population having been of the country having been displaced from their homes, and roughly half of that half outside of the country. So the most important factor for the displacement is, of course, the fighting itself. We have also quite a lot of secondary displacement of persons who have immediately left the areas where military action is taking place, and there it is a lack of opportunity that is the main driving force. There has been an element in the Syrian conflict of, I think one can say that fairly confidently, deliberate cleansing of some areas. We are seeing even in areas that are being held by the regime and are relatively safe, that it's difficult for people who have lived in these areas and are now internally displaced in regime-controlled areas in Syria to return to those places. And as long as they are not allowed to return to their homes, even if they are, from a security point, safe, of course, there is a push to seek other opportunities. This enormous displacement that has taken place has also, of course, created opportunities for the people who make a profit out of the plight of the refugees, and it has become a business, a huge business, to assist refugees to move to other parts of the world, not least Europe. In terms of the refugees actually being used deliberately as the weaponization of the refugee file, I am more hesitant to say anything to give any definite conclusions on this. But what I think one can say with some confidence is that if the enormous flow of refugees that we have seen to Europe is creating confusion and havoc in Europe, in the European Union, between European member states, from the point of view of Moscow, maybe this at least can be might be regarded as a, from that point of view, positive fallout of the conflict. The refugees themselves are, I have met many refugees and internally displaced persons now in Lebanon and Syria and in other places, and most of them are in a very precarious situation. At the same time, I have found that many of them, for example, in Lebanon, which is a country that has taken the most refugees of any country in the world, or per capita holds the largest number of refugees of any country in the world, with 1.5 million on a population of 4 million people. This country is carrying an enormous burden with enormous difficulties in providing education opportunities for children. For example, only half of the refugee children attend school. So the pressure to seek other opportunities is enormous. I have found also, when I've talked to the refugees, that they have a very rational way of looking at their future and their opportunities. They are seeking information, and they often have quite good information from relatives and friends and neighbors in other countries as a basis for deciding where they how long they will stay where they are and where they will go, and based also on how much it will cost.
Hopefully we'll be able to talk a little bit also about the possible solutions, as you just mentioned, so maybe in a few minutes. Professor Dorronsoro, you did the research on refugee in refugee camps, on refugees seeking refuge from oppression from ISIS in Kurdistan, and also from Shia militias, also running away from them in Iraq to the Iraqi Kurdistan. Please give us the social description of what could happen to our imagined Mr. Issa in those refugee camps, and what drives these people to run away from the places where they lived, and then later on to the to Europe.
Well, thanks, Piotr. Maybe the first thing to say is that most of the people we met in Syria, also because we were both in both countries, were not fleeing actually the Islamic State per se, because safety is the main important thing. So, to a certain extent, when you were living in Mosul, you were able to have a kind of safety. The economy was a disaster, but at least you had, to a certain extent, safety. And so that's the first thing. People most of the time were fleeing because, if they were from Syria, because of Bashar al-Assad, because of bombing. That was the main reason. And also because they knew that nobody was going to help them. September 2013, when Obama refused to intervene after the chemical attacks against the population, was the first sign. And what they are seeing now with Aleppo is the second sign. So they know that they're on their own, except maybe Turkey, but that's another question. So their projection of the future is very rational. I totally agree with that. They understand that they are alone. They want safety. So the problem is a kind of arbitration between what they have, where they are now, for example, in Mosul, and what they are going to find outside. And that's where it's very important to take into account the question of IDPs. The problem is not only refugees, actually, it's IDPs. So if you're a Sunni Arab and you're living right now in Mosul, you want to flee because you know that it's going to be a mess, okay. But what's your future? If you stay in Iraq, basically, you're going to be in a refugee camp. You're going to be treated as a foreigner if you go to Kurdistan. Your future is very bleak if you're going to Shia areas in the south. So the most logical solution is to go out of Iraq. And to a certain extent, we have the same thing in Syria too. People, they don't necessarily like the Islamic State. At the beginning, maybe in Mosul, they were so happy to be rid of the Shia militia that sometime, you know, well, for a few months. But no, they want to leave, but to go where exactly? They cannot stay in the country because there is no safe zone, except maybe for now a little territory in the north of Syria. But if you want to go outside, you have to go directly to Turkey. And that's why you have 3 million people in Turkey. They would like to come back, but they have no opportunity. So that's the first thing. It's totally irrational choice. The second thing maybe to say is that people most of the time have trouble moving, because if they move, they know they are going to lose everything. So if the city is not totally destroyed, except the activist, but if the city is not totally destroyed, they tend to stay the same place, because they don't want to lose their house, and refugee camps are a very hard place, as you know, especially in Iraq. And that's interesting also to notice that
The fall of Mosul is an obvious thing since at least 1 year, and nobody was prepared for the refugees, for the IDPs. So also they know that. So they know that if they are leaving Mosul, the most rational choice is to go outside Iraq. And again, you know. So these people basically don't have a lot of solutions. And they don't trust much the NGOs, the United Nations, and all these international organizations, because they are not doing enough.
So we are on the other side of the Mediterranean right now in Europe. And first question, before I go to the social reception, I mean the social reaction in Europe towards the refugees, because we are most interested in the security issues, would be, what are our, what the institutions that are meant to somehow prevent the violent acts to happen, what they are doing? What is the level of cooperation of these special services in Europe? How they try to vet the coming refugees? And my question to Sir Richard Barrett will be to explain, is it the myth or is it the fact that to some extent the waves of refugees may be kind of stained by the people who are, you know, devoted to commit violent acts?
Well, the refugee problem, of course, is a global problem. It's not just a European problem. And I think the UN estimate last year, the end of last year, was that there were 65.3 million refugees in the world. That's the end of 2015. That's an enormous number. And, of course, dwarfs the number of people coming out of war-torn societies, whether Syria, Afghanistan, Yemen, Somalia, and so on. But if we look at Europe and what do we do to try and prevent refugees creating a security problem for Europe, I think the first thing to say in that is that refugees in themselves are not a high-risk group. It's not the refugees generally who create a problem, although the public perception, of course, is. And if you remember, there was a Pew survey in many European countries in July, I think, included Poland, and 71% of Poles thought that refugees would increase the problem of terrorism in Poland. But despite those public perceptions, in fact, if you think of the well over a million refugees now within the EU from Syria, Iraq, so far there's only been about 10 who've been charged with terrorist offences. So refugees themselves are not the key problem with this. But of course, when people come in a refugee flow, the key question is, who are they? And that is very difficult to determine. I think over the last year in Germany, 70% of people presenting themselves for asylum or refugee status were without any documentation at all. So very difficult to determine not only who they are, but of course where they came from as well. And they may not disclose that they came from Syria. But even when you've tried to determine who they are, you then have to determine why they've come. If they've come as refugees, as I say, that's not necessarily a big problem, but if they come within the refugee flow as a returning foreign fighter, for example, and we've had, what, about 6,000, 5,000 or 6,000 people from Western countries go to Syria, Iraq, to join Islamic State or other violent extremist groups there, of which about a third have already returned. So let's say, conservatively, that's about 1,500 people already back. Well, these aren't refugees, of course, because they're people who had some right of residence within the EU, but they may have come back as refugees without documentation because they reckon they may be on stop lists and so on. And these stop lists are growing, and that's why finding out who they are is really critical, because the databases are becoming more and more sophisticated and better distributed as well. So as well as being possible returning foreign fighters, and many returning foreign fighters actually aren't high risk either, funnily enough. If you talk to security services around Europe today, they'll tell you that returnees have not been particularly involved in terrorist threats. But Islamic State supporters who've been inserted by Islamic State within the refugee flow, of course, have been a problem, as we saw in Paris, for example, and in Brussels attacks in November and January, November last year and January this year. And of course, we understand from Islamic State propaganda, and it may just be propaganda, that they have had a policy of trying to send people back to commit terrorist attacks in Europe. We wait to see. It's certainly not on the scale that Islamic State claims, but nonetheless, there will be others. There will be other people who've come who may have thought, well, I just want to get out of all this, but then may revert to sympathy with Islamic State. Well, there may be others who become sympathetic, as indeed, I believe, may have happened with a recent case in Chemnitz. You remember the Syrian refugee who got turned in, funnily enough, by other refugees, which is also significant. But as he arrived in Germany in February 2015 and only started plotting to attack a target in Berlin a few months back, then it may be that he got radicalized after arrival. So many, many problems, all right. So who are they, why have they come, and what is the likely projection of their thinking and activity while they're here? Well, how do we deal with that? Well, the main thing is to deal with it in a legal manner. I mean, refugees have rights, asylum seekers have rights, and it is a fundamental counterterrorism instrument to act according to the rule of law. As soon as we abandon the rule of law, then we hand terrorists a free pass, an advantage, an equivalence, enormously dangerous. So we have to act by the rule of law, which often, of course, people complain gives the terrorists an advantage. But nonetheless, it's extremely important that we do. And the second issue is resources. The resources of dealing with this massive flow of refugees are just not available to European countries, even those who have the biggest security and intelligence services. There are just too many of them. So there has to be a whole lot of prioritization, but a whole lot of sharing information between us. And although you may argue, well, we should have more resources, we should look at them more closely. Well, if you look at Frontex has very few resources. In fact, it has very few Arabic speakers. So as a start, makes their job extremely difficult. But even when we come to national security, I don't think many of us would want to live in a society where we had the resources to look at every single new arrival in our country. I think that would be just too much and more than we're prepared to put up with. So we should be ready to take a risk. And in that, we share information between us. Of course, we're jealous of our own information, but we do share it, because if there's a threat to another state, an allied state, then certainly we would want to tell them about it. And that networking, that sharing of information, has become a critical weapon, not just with the United States, but also with countries, of course, like Turkey, which is absolutely critical in the fight against
ISIS. You said sharing, but why is it always that the first information about the possible threat comes from the United States? Well, like in the case of this German, the case you mentioned of the young person who, well, by the way, later committed suicide in jail. But the first information came from United States and was, well, only received with surprise by the German intelligence.
Well, I can say it doesn't always come from the United States first, and sometimes it does, and we're very grateful to the United States for their cooperation, and sometimes information of value to the United States comes first from European countries. Mm-hmm. So there's a proper sharing there.
Okay. Professor English, you have very interesting point of view on the phenomenon of terrorism in Europe. You did your research mostly on the IRA in Northern Ireland. And in your books and articles, you say that basically just we have to get over it. We have to get used to it. This is the fact of life. This is something that we should, of course, we should fight with, but we should live with it at the same time. Could you tell us your description of how European societies react at the moment to this new wave, so-called new wave of terrorism that is somehow connected with the waves of refugees.
Thanks very much, and thank you for the invitation to be here. It's great to be back in Warsaw again. In terms of the context which our imagined traveller will find in Europe, I just want to identify three ones which I think are particularly important, especially as they relate to terrorism and the connection between terrorism and migration. And those three are exaggeration, polarization, and confusion. First, there's an exaggeration in Europe of the degree of threat which there is actually faced in regard to terrorism at the moment. This is not to say that terrorism is not a threat which can be occasionally and appallingly lethal. The events in France, Belgium, Germany, and elsewhere show that it is, and appallingly so for the victims. But it is to say that we too often make general judgments about patterns of threat on the basis of a small number of highly memorable, very eye-catching incidents. And if you look at the figures, there was far more terrorism in Western Europe in the 1970s and 1980s than there is now. And therefore, we shouldn't be blinded by the appallingly eye-catching nature of what's actually happening in terms of attacks in Brussels or Paris, appalling though they are. So the first thing that would greet our visitor would be that there would be an exaggeration of the capacity of someone who was actually planning violence to damage Europe, and an exaggeration of the likelihood of a migrant coming to Europe being a terrorist. Second thing is polarization. My most recent book is about whether terrorism works or not. One thing terrorism repeatedly does succeed in achieving is polarization among targeted societies where the violence is used. It's much more common to generate polarization through terrorism than it is to get the headline strategic goals which the terrorist organizations say they want. That latter thing is quite rare, but gaining polarization is very easy. And in different, very different ways, between the different countries, for example, represented on this platform or in this room, in very different ways across Europe, there has been a stark polarization, not just in response to terrorism, not just in response to migration, but both reinforced by that. But I think in addition to exaggeration and polarization, the visitor would also find a measure of confusion. In terms of migration, there has not been a particularly carefully thought through analysis of why the migration is happening in its various different ways from the different contexts which have generated it, with the different concentrations of people coming to certain countries and not others from certain places, and why. I think there has not been a sufficient recognition in Europe of the generation of the conflicts which have produced migration and exactly who's responsible for some of those and for contributing to some of those. And the point I'd close on is a particularly pessimistic one, which is that the levels of migration we've seen in recent years coming into Europe are as nothing compared to the levels of migration which there will be during the coming century, particularly when climate change migration kicks in. So if we think it's going to be confusing, polarizing, and so on now, we really should now try to think about how as societies, whether in legal terms, in policing terms, in political terms, in terms of social interaction, how we deal with this phenomenon, because it's not going to get less of an issue, it's probably going to grow as more. So in terms of how this relates to terrorism, it seems that the exaggeration, the polarization, and the confusion of thinking about this, all of them, I think, Piotr, make it worse. In other words, we find a common pattern that if we think what really changes history, it's not so much terrorism, it's how we respond to it. And at the moment, I regret to say that my diagnosis of how society would welcome our imagined traveller suggests a pessimistic reading rather than an optimistic one.
Well, indeed, we treat the current wave of attack as something new in Europe, like we kind of lost the memory of 70s of Red Army or the Red Brigades in Italy, but there is a country in the Middle East that lives under constant threat, and we are lucky to have Mr. Schweitzer from Israel. Israel seemed to also adjust it somehow to the constant threat of constant fighting with this phenomenon. But still develops new tools to fight it. You did your research on wannabe suicide bombers. You did research on a terrorist organization in the Middle East, mostly coming from Gaza Strip. Could you give us, in a European setup, objective description of your experiences, of Israel experiences with terrorism, and maybe some possible solution as a conclusion of the first round of this discussion.
So you're coming to Israel to have solutions, huh? Look, the principles of fighting terrorism is the same everywhere. Principles, the environment, the kind of the history of the those who commit terror attacks, the conditions have to be adjusted to the specific issues. In Israel, we have been dealing with terrorism since our inception as a sovereign state and even before that. We have various kinds of terror attacks from various groups developing enemies with different tactics. Some of them are applicable to Europe, some of them has to be adjusted. I think that in my training 35 years ago when I started this business, I looked at international terrorism, not as an Israeli, but as a spectator and somebody who works with these kind of challenges. I think agility, understanding the nature of the enemies, of the tactics they are using, the change of tactics by different groups is key issues to try to fight it, because the principle should be to separate the terrorists from the general audience, because the aims of the terrorists is specifically to provoke governments to overreact to terrorism. And we need to understand the mindset of terrorists and the strategy of terrorists in order to defeat them. So first, we make separation between terrorists and the larger population. When we identify specific modus operandi that are prevailing, for example, when we in Israel have encountered a tsunami of suicide bombers in what is known as the Second Intifada, we were surprised because of the massive number of suicide bombers, how the people were recruited, who were the recruiters, how they recruit, and we tried to face it. And eventually it took us quite a long time, but we managed to overcome this and to make the price for the terrorists higher than the achievements. We also needed to brief our population on the nature of the threat. I totally agree with Professor English that there is always a risk of overreaction, not only by the politicians, who sometimes like to do it, but also by the public. The public must be informed and take part in the reaction to terrorism, because it's very easy to be manipulated by terror, by the image of terrorism, because usually they are not that many, they are not that smart, they are not capable of defeating any normal state, and you need to be very surgical in reaction not only to the specific people, but also to the strategic aims of the terrorists. So I hate to give advices to others, because I think that there are enough smart people in any of the countries all over the world that you don't need some Middle Eastern experts coming to tell you what to do. But we have to be very, very careful how we define the enemies, how we fight it, how we involve the population with it. We also have to take care of the population to develop resilience within the population. And this is something that, unfortunately, in our unfortunate situation, we managed to do it not by only by the government, but also by NGOs.
Yes, this is a very interesting point. I remember I was visiting Brussels during the high alert last year, and I spotted, it was empty, basically empty city, except for soldiers with the really long machine guns walking the streets. And I thought, okay, even if they spot terrorists, how they will shoot him? I mean, this is something really inappropriate in the face of possible threat. So the point you made about, you know, who should educate actually society, community, what works better, governmental so-called education or NGOs who can also do something? What is the type of education that NGOs could give to the society based on your experience?
I can tell you in Israel we have initiated by a civilian who established a hotline with psychologists that are listening to people who are victims of terrorism and talk to them. And it was developed through the years and became a very serious organization that emulated by others. Some of them were because again, we have ample of kinds of terrorism, shooting, launching blindly rockets from one side to the other to the cities of Israel is one kind of terrorism. And we developed in the southern part of Israel community facilities and community professional people who deal with the young population, with the females, with the men who were totally terrorized because they suffered what I can designate as a Chinese torture. You know, every day or every 2 days or three times a week, just one small little bomb or rocket. And then we had people in the cities when we were encountered with tsunami of suicide bombings in the cities. So, and there is a lesson learned by time, by people, and we developed various kinds of these social community services which deal with it. And of course, one crucial component is leadership in the level of the nation. If the politicians, if the prime minister, if the people from the army who represent security and confidence for the public, they can, the way they behave, the way they talk about it, is very crucial to calm the population and to inform them. And when people are aware of the size and the magnitude of the threat, they can cope, especially if you don't have any other alternative.
Thank you. Okay, so we have kind of completed our first journey, and of course the current situation is that terrorism kind of is connected with ISIS seems to be going to the end with the end of ISIS as we can observe. I mean, nowadays the expected fall of Mosul in a hopefully weeks should bring the dismantling ISIS as a state, as an organization. Gilles, could you tell us a little bit more about how ISIS ruled before, and what would you expect after the fall of Mosul, how they could preserve their organization, their freedom of maneuver, and the things that we connected, that we used to describe the ISIS as an organization.
First, just to come back to what was said, I think what was clear is that there is not much connection between terrorism and refugees so far. At least in the case of France, as you know, all the terrorists were very much French. So far there is no relationship. So I think,
but they were kind of a seasoned fighters from before. I mean, they traveled to Syria or Iraq before,
no,
right?
That could happen. But what I mean is, it's quite important if you want to educate the public to say that first, the people who committed these horrible acts were basically French. So we have a few questions to address to ourselves. So about ISIS, and this is a way to answer your question, because so far the threat was coming from people who were actually linked, even by internet, not just by internet, linked to the ISIS in Raqqa. It's going to disappear. This kind of relationship is going to disappear. At the same time, the situation of the Sunni Arabs in Iraq and in Syria is such that it's sure that you will have some fights for the next few years, at least, or even longer term. Plus the fact that you have ISIS now in Afghanistan, as you know, that in
Mali and all these areas. There's also some groups in Libya too. So I think it's the end of the central, the caliphate as a territorial structure. It's not the end of the movement. And what we are most probably going to see is the same kind of faraway relationship through internet and probably the same kind of terrorist act. I don't think the refugees are quite central here.
So Richard, you made the same distinction in one of the interviews that you said that we have to distinguish ISIS as an organization and as an idea. Do you think that idea will prevail after the fall of the organization?
Yes, I think this is exactly the same as with Al-Qaeda, for example, who got knocked extremely hard since 2001, but nonetheless
But Al-Qaeda as an idea is kind of already done. I mean,
well, Al-Qaeda and Islamic State, of course, come from the same root. I mean, it's the same problems. And why Islamic State has been so successful in Syria, Iraq in particular, is the same reasons that Al-Qaeda got support, in that there's lack of governance, that there's lack of opportunity, there's no predictable justice, you know, justice is very partial, and so on, and there's lack of stability. And what Islamic State did, which Al-Qaeda didn't do, of course, which was solve these problems, not by hanging around and building public support like Al-Qaeda tried to do, but by taking territory and imposing their will. And that takes advantage of sectarianism, which will continue once they've been pushed out of Mosul and Raqqa, and it takes advantage of the fact that the institutions in Syria and Iraq are incredibly weak. The institutions have been built to support the leadership, not to serve the people. And these institutions won't suddenly be invented once Mosul and Raqqa fall. So these people, and it was said very clearly by Islamic State, which has been spinning, of course, their defeats considerably over the last weeks, but it was said even by Abu Muhammad al-Adnani, the spokesman who was killed not so very long ago, that why do you in the West think we're defeated just because we lose territory? You will never defeat us so long as we have this idea and we can fight even in the desert.
And a little bit from a global politics, Peter, we are hopefully coming to the end of the US campaign, where the two candidates are giving different ways of coping with ISIS. What do you think would be a policy, for instance, future President Hillary Clinton, when she says that Assad should go away and this kind of what is it, what does it mean in reality?
Well, I'm not sure that I'm the person to answer that question. I don't see that we will have any major change in terms of policy. We would probably see a more somewhat more assertive policy, but I don't know how much time it will take to actually formulate a policy and implement it. Every administration will have to go through a period of policy review until they're ready to unfold their policies. I remember, actually, without making too much out of the parallel, what happened the last time a Clinton administration came to power in 1993, I think it was, when the Bosnia War was going on, and there was a plan on the table, the Vance Owen plan, to end the war, but it didn't materialize in the end because of the policy reviews that took place in Washington, and only 2.5 years later, after the intervention of Richard Holbrooke, did we have a force and political capital invested in a solution that ultimately looked very much the same as that plan had looked in 1990 in January 1993. But I don't want to make too much out of this parallel. There are many other things that need to be done as well. I fear that regardless of whether we are going to have a more assertive policy that will fill a little bit of this vacuum that the Damascus regime and the Russians and others are using. We need also other policies, and unfortunately the war is probably going to go on for some more time. Aleppo is one of the important remaining battles, but there are other battles as well to be fought, and we should be prepared for further displacement as well of people from Syria and other places in the Middle East. We need to make sure that if there is another way, we are better prepared than before. The EU needs to get its act together, and all the member states need to realize that there is it's necessary for everybody to take a greater degree of collective responsibility. We need to do more in order to support host communities in countries in the Middle East where there are large concentrations of refugees, Lebanon and Jordan being cases in point. We need a better global management of migration issues. We also need a more better management of the return of refugees. There are lots of things to make sure that we are, and as has been discussed here several times before in this conference, a better and more effective management of the external borders of the European Union. So there's a lot that needs to be done on the European side as well, regardless of what the policies in Washington are going to be, because this problem is going to be with us probably for some time to come.
You used, before I give the audience opportunity to ask you a question, let me ask the one that kind of sum up our conversation. You used the word fear, and we are sitting here experts on the matter, giving very rational solutions, answers, but there is something like emotions connected with the issues that we are discussing, and the emotions drives policies, drives people to the conclusions that are not necessarily nice, but still there needs to be a answer to these emotions as well. Professor English, who recently published a book about how to deal with terrorism, can terrorism win? One of your reviewers asked you, what about emotions, about emotions of the researcher, but also emotions of a societies who actually can listen to our rational explanation, but still there is a fear in the basement of all thinking about the issues that we are talking here. So question is actually to you, but also to rest of us, to short summary how to deal with emotions that are connected with this basic actually need and for protection against violence.
Thank you. It's a really important point about emotions, because clearly, both in terms of the horror people feel when violence is used against them or their community, also the sense of the malignity of intention behind the attacks, which makes it different from other more statistically dangerous things like road accidents or whatever. The notion that somebody is planning to do damage to you and to do harm to you makes it emotionally very threatening. And I think those senses of emotional responses can determine politics. Politicians often feel they need to show a certain kind of reaction in order that they match the emotional mood of the country and so on. All of that is true. It remains also true that throughout the history of terrorism, an overreaction or an over-reliance on emotional responses has tend to be disastrous in terms of actual loss of life. And when you're dealing with a disease, if you go and see a doctor about an illness, you don't want the doctor emotionally to bang their hand on the table saying, cancer is a many-headed hydra of evil that must be stamped out whenever we see it, because you think you got the wrong doctor if that was the response from your medic. What you want is somebody to engage in the kind of discussion we've all been engaging in at this conference, which is calmly and patiently to think, what's going to minimize human suffering? Now, there are public ways of presenting that, which deal with the emotions of victims, with the anxieties of societies. I fully understand that. But I think an over-reliance on emotional responses tends to mean that there'll be more loss of limb and life in the future, which will then reinforce the things we're trying to deal with. So I would defend the dispassionate space of analysis, because I think that if you don't do that, you're more likely to make the thing worse rather than better.
Yes, please.
Well, I just wanted to mention another poll that you may have seen by CSIS, the Center for Strategic and International Studies in Washington, earlier this month. A poll taken of 8,000 people in 8 countries, including China, UK, US, France, India, Indonesia, Turkey, and Egypt, I believe. And that poll of those such a wide, diverse range of countries found that over 80% saw terrorism as a major problem, with over half of those respondents saying it was the number one problem that their country faced. Now, that is quite extraordinary and shows the power of terrorism, which is precisely, as Richard says, an emotional power. It's out of all proportion to the threat that you or I may face, or anybody in this room may face from terrorism, which is so minute as to be statistically unmentionable. I don't know whether in Israel citizens yes. feel more at risk, but it's still very, very small. And so what do we do about this? Because for so long as terrorism has that impact, it will be used as a tactic. And it's only when social resilience is stronger, so that the impact of terrorism is less, that it will stop. And unfortunately, in this age of growing populism, politicians are all too quick to reach for that, oh, we're going to protect you better than the other lot type of mantra, which is completely meaningless, of course, to get support.
Any short answers from very emotional nations like France or Israel? How to deal with the emotions?
I'll give you very short examples. First of all, I was spending time talking to terrorists in jail, the worst of the worst, and we had a gentleman agreement. I told them, you all deserve to be killed before you send all the suicide bombers. All of you had to get a bullet in the head, but let's talk. And I was talking to them, never went emotional, almost never. And in order to analyze, to understand what was going on behind it, I knew all the words, I wanted to listen to the music. Second, when Israel is faced with terrorism, and it has been faced with terrorism all the time, the main mission is to bounce back as soon as possible. It's horrible how quickly a scene of suicide bombing was evacuated in Israel and came back to normalcy, or alleged normalcy. It takes 40 minutes to clean the worst of the worst scenes. And people continue their life. People in Israel fear, people have emotions, people will sometimes overreact. But the only way to deal with it, especially with it, is a continuous phenomenon, is to live normally as possible as one can.
Well, I had the same feeling when I was sitting at the table with Taliban. What a great chap.
Well, Gilles. Maybe I would say, I will take another point of view. What's striking me is both a lot of emotions, but also the lack of emotions. When chemical weapons are used in Syria, it's front page of French newspaper, nobody is doing anything. So when you have Aleppo destroyed by bombing every day, the public reaction is zero. So we are both extremely emotional about certain things, but the frame, the way we interpret the reality, means that also we are totally blind to other things. We are blind to what's happening in Afghanistan. We are basically blind to what's happening in Iraq, except the specific problem of ISIS. And I think this is extremely dangerous.
Thank you. I hope there will be some need from the audience to reveal this blind spot. So please, I hope for a forest of hands asking questions.
Thank you very much for this excellent presentation. My name is Marcin Buzanski from the Pulaski Foundation. I wanted to give a comment on the question. I just picked up, looked at the statistics, I remember it. It's from the Washington Post. Between January 2015 and I think July 2016, there are recorded, 658 terror attacks in Western world in both of the Americas with 658 casualties and 46 attacks. And then for the rest, we've got 2,063 with nearly 30,000 casualties. Now, I think that's something quite telling if we think about the aspect of terrorism and those emotions that that have been raised right here, and something that is very easily forgotten. And why I'm mentioning this, because isn't it the case that actually the policies that we have been, I mean the Western world, conducting for quite a long time, are actually one of the biggest origins of what we're dealing with right now? And I'm thinking here about the whole doctrine, quote unquote, of war on terror. I'm thinking now about Iraq, and I'm kind of looking at what's planned, because I don't really see a plan currently, and I'm wondering, aren't we fueling the same very thing that we're trying to find an answer to? And what would be the solutions, considering the political challenges, considering the geopolitical challenges, and those human emotions challenges that were just raised here? Because I feel that those societies who looked more into Europe are now feeling more and more alienated. And they fear, I think, our bombs as much as they fear the others. So I'd like to hear your opinions and views. Thank you.
Well, on that, it's the statistics on the levels of terrorist incidents and levels of terrorist-generated fatality during the phase of the global war on terror make depressing reading, because whichever database you look at, the figures go up during that period. I've argued that one of the key reasons they went up was because of the over-militarization of response at that time, which I think did tend to reinforce some of the narratives of the people whom we were trying quite rightly to deal with. On the answers, I don't think there are any easy answers, but what I would stress would be, first of all, to think more about long-term engagement than we tend to find politically acceptable. We tend to have very short-term narratives of when success has to be dealt with, before the next election or before the next speech or in reaction to the latest event. I would take a longer-term approach. I'd also say that we need to be more context specific. I think the things that are going to be challenges in dealing with what happens in France will be different from the things that are appropriate in Israel. And I think we need to recognize the specificity of terrorist challenges, which, though they share a lot of resemblances, have local dynamics too. So I think, yes, we often make things worse, I think often by over-militarizing a response inappropriately. And I think we need to be more long-term and more context specific. But I do recognize that we're not going to solve this. What we're going to do is answer a question, better or worse, rather than solve a problem once and for all.
Gilles, please.
Yeah, maybe if to follow on what you're saying, two things. First, the Obama administration actually made everything that was humanly possible to build the social base of Jabhat al-Nusra. So I think it could be a problem. Second, what we did in Afghanistan, actually, the result of that is that Al-Qaeda has a sanctuary forever in Afghanistan. That's the second. I'm not really convinced that what we did in Mali and Libya was that clever. So yes, we are actually creating the problem. And what we are doing right now in Syria is a catastrophe. It's exactly the same kind of catastrophe we did in Afghanistan. And now, in 5 years, we are going to see some strange guys coming and we'll say, why do they hate us? Yeah, okay. So no, it's depressing, actually.
Wow, seems like we are just starting. Yoram, please. Yeah.
I don't want to disregard the grievances and the faults of the West and others. I would like to mention two things. One, we are talking about philosophy of jihadiya Salafiya jihadiya. The Salafiya jihadiya philosophy was not raised, was not followed, has not been invented because of the atrocities of the West. They are against Muslims. They are against Muslims who think differently. They will butcher Muslims in any time they refute their supremacy and their interpretation of Islam. So without taking any reservation of some of the things that were said here, we need to understand what is the enemy that we face. We are not talking as an Israeli. Second, I don't think that what happened in the Middle East and not in Syria specifically has to do with the West. And I don't know anything about the future. I'm among those. But it's quite obvious that the situation in Syria, not only in Syria, but in Syria, will produce in future youngsters, uneducated, tortured, tormented, who suffered post-traumatic effects that will resort to terrorism in future. This is something that should be tackled on humanitarian basis with political solutions, but it will produce terrorism. So it's not always the fault of the West. Of course, there are other elements that are not to my liking as an Israeli, as a person of the world, that can be mitigated and can find solutions with. But the specific current that is now prevailing, not only by IS, but also by Al-Qaeda and its affiliates, which have a lot of in common, they are seeking to destroy the Western civilization as it is. It's not a slogan. It's not propaganda. This is, if you read and learn and study what they are looking for, that's the issue, regardless any things that we are going to do.
Richard, please.
Thank you. Just a couple of comments on your comment before addressing the other bit. I think of the American casualties from terrorist attack, the majority were caused by right-wing terrorism rather than by Islamic extremist violence or whatever we want to call it. And the second comment on your comment is, of course, that many more Muslims are being killed through terrorist attacks than non-Muslims, vastly more, because Pakistan, Iraq, Afghanistan, of course, and so on, these countries have suffered probably more than any other, but possibly from Nigeria, where also many Muslims are being killed. As for culpability, I think that we could argue that either way. You know, I might not agree with everything you've just said, but we are where we are. And I think when we look forward, we're looking forward in a very globalized world, so that responsibility is now shared, whoever may have been to blame by action or inaction. And I think one of the tragedies of Syria is that it remains in 2016, 5 years after the revolution began, that all the players involved, whether they're regional or non-regional players, have other things in mind, other objectives in mind, before they have peace in Syria. Peace in Syria still comes way down the list. And I think that is a tragedy, as Gilles said, that we have to begin to address and overcome.
Yes, please.
just to answer what you're saying, the problem is not that you have a Salafist jihadist movement. We totally agree on this. The problem is, how is it possible for this guy to build a social base? That's the problem, okay? To build a social base. Followers, that's not the problem of ideology. Ideology is everywhere. But when ideology is becoming a kind of social phenomenon, then you have a problem. The problem is not Al-Qaeda, it's not Bin Laden. The problem is that now, because what we did, Al-Qaeda has a base, and more than a base, in Afghanistan. That's the problem. You understand what I mean? It's not ideology, the problem. Ideology is everywhere.
I understand, I just don't agree.
Yeah.
We just have just very short one question. Yes, please, gentlemen. Here.
Oh. My name is Piotr Sosnowski. I'm working in War Studies University in Poland. And I have more comment than question. So what is the reason of that situation in Syria and Iraq now are the borders, borders which are not respecting the people who are living there, the many ethnicities and religions, and that borders are destabilizing that region. It's easy to destabilize people who are not respected by their governments, and they will not, if the borders will not change. So I have been many times in Iraqi Kurdistan and in Turkey. I did some field researches, and also that year, and I found that those people, there's 40 million people without the state, they are Kurds. So our effort of the Western civilization, in my opinion, should be to help those people to live in the country which respect their law to self-determinate. And so this is my first comment. And the second, now the Mosul operation approaching and the Kurdish region in Iraq, which have 5 million inhabitants, this kind of quasi-state, taking care about 2 million of refugee and IDPs. There is international support there, there is some NGOs, but still there is hundreds of million dollars missing to help those people. And we expecting that in time of Mosul operation, more than 1 million people, more than one IDPs will come to Iraqi Kurdistan. And it will be more than half of inhabitants of that region. So without our help from West, that region will be destabilized more. In the future, it will become like a manufacturer of terrorism, anti-Western. And also Russians are using that, the Europe and the Western world are not helping enough for that region. The Russian propaganda using this. If you will read the Russian media, just last sentence. If you read Russian media in the Arab language or Kurmanji language, you will find how they are using that situation for destabilizing that region and turn it to anti-Western terrorism manufacture. Thanks.
So thank you very much, and let me conclude with agreeing what Yoram said, that while we are mourning our dead, the thousands of Muslims are being killed for the sake of their own rivalries and hatred. But someone said that only our dead are important, and this is the thing about emotions that we just spoke recently. With that, thank you very much. Please give us the big round of applause, and thank you very much.